thank you all for being here. We have about 20 minutes for six really fascinating people. So this is really going to be a chance to get a taste of their interests and to just start the conversations which we will continue over coming days. So let me, without taking up any of their time, let me invite Faris Hassan to come speak. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I think it's quite challenging to address this esteemed gathering by first apologizing for our Director General, Mr. Sulaiman Al-Herbish. My name is Faris Hassan. I'm Director of Corporate Planning, and I'm replacing him due to some urgent commitments. But I will start first with many questions that came to me during the past 2 days. What is OPIC doing with theoretical physics? And I said, okay, let me answer it through four links. The first link is that it's not theoretical physics, we found out. They have many applications, including renewable energy, desertification, and we had good cooperation with them on applied subjects as well. Second is that we're not OPEC. We are OPEC Fund for International Development. We were established in 1976 by the member countries of OPEC to channel their assistance to developing countries. So the first link is the focus on developing countries between us and ICTP. Of course, since our establishment, we have committed over $17 billion of assistance to developing countries, and we are very conscious that this assistance should mature through the continuous maintenance by scientific achievements. How we do that, our assistance is channeled to reach all the sectors of society. So we give sovereign loans for infrastructure projects. We give private sector loans to small and medium enterprises. And we also come down to the level of poor farmers by helping them to export their agricultural products through our trade finance facility. We also cater for the bottom of the pyramid, which is the poorest of the poor, through our grants. This leads me to the second linkage with ICTP, which is technical assistance and research. In our grants, we have six programs. One of them is for research. We collaborate with institutions like you, like Lindau Foundations, like the EASA, like IAEE, which is economics, agriculture, system analysis, and all kind of scientific research in the service of development. One of our programs is for energy, which is the third link between us and ICTP. I understand that they have made a renewable energy program, and since 2007, our heads of state have mandated OFID to help alleviating energy poverty around the world. Since then, we have been doing many activities in advocacy and research, and in 2012, we announced a $1 billion of assistance money only for energy poverty alleviation. And within 2 years, we spent this, and we had to announce in 2013 that it is going to be on revolving ground. So we hope that with ICTP, we can pursue even further this task. This leads me to the third linkage with ICTP, which is the Sustainable Development Goals. I was afraid that this is going to be a long explanation, but I am very happy that UNESCO and IAEA all explained before me the subject. And within the Sustainable Development Goals, we have chosen three. We have chosen energy, food, and water as focus for our assistance to all the developing countries. And we hope that together with ICTP, we will find research areas that address not only these subjects, but the nexus between them. Because with climate change, as we heard this morning, many countries are going to be vulnerable either from water side or from energy side or from food security side. So this is a tip for ICTP research. But with all these four linkages, the objective of our future collaboration would be finding scientific solutions for local problems contributing to the development and capacity building inside the economies of the developing countries. And I would like to echo what Dr. Shahabuddin has just mentioned, and that is results-based scientific research will enhance more contributions from the countries towards scientific research. So we would start not a vicious cycle, but a positive cycle of funding research, one complementing the other. And I'm very happy that the panel before me, Mr. Gibbs, also are concentrating on energy access and decentralized energy access and the role of renewables. So it looks like all efforts and all the opinions are focusing on the same thing, and this will ensure our success in the future. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Hassan. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Ayako Fukui.
Thank you, Ian, and thank you, Director Kevada, for the invitation. So Professor Briggs has introduced the mission of the Templeton Foundation in the previous session, so I will not repeat it here, but I would like to add that our founder, Sir John Templeton's visions and ideas, along with the scope and his action, had always been global. And Sir John was the pioneer of global mutual funds, being among the first who invested globally, recognizing the long-term growth potential of emerging economies. He did not just focus on the current state of affairs, but paid more attention to the fundamental long-term future growth possibilities. All of the Templeton Foundations strive to keep this global perspective in mind in its funding investment in scientific research. And the John Templeton Foundation considers supporting curiosity-driven research and creating an environment in which it is fostered a priority in building capacity for scientific research in general. The Templeton Foundation puts emphasis on supporting unconventional, high-risk, high-return type of research that are generally not funded by federal agencies due to the fact that they may not have short-term impacts. The current academic structure does not give incentives to research conducting curiosity-driven research either, and I believe that we need to make adjustment by collaboration between policymakers, scientists, and various types of funders. However, private source of funding should not replace public funding, but rather it should be considered a complementary research resource that can fill the gap that public funding cannot fill. There may also be competing agendas between agencies or countries, but we need to focus on finding synergies to succeed in building capacity for scientific research on a global scale. And to that end, the global community of funding agencies should consider and continue to seek to innovate in and experiment with various funding mechanisms to support research in creative ways. For instance, short-term startup seed funding mechanism to pilot emerging ideas may be employed in certain cases. We may also consider challenge competitions as a tool to foster innovation. In 2013, the Templeton Foundation has participated in sponsoring Platform Technology Prize competition in collaboration with the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy and five other private science foundations within the US. All funding agencies, including White House OSTP, recognize that platform technologies have captured a significant fraction of all the science Nobel Prizes in the last 10 years. And this challenge competition sought to identify exceptional ideas for revolutionary new platform technology that could lead to breakthrough advances in the broadly defined life sciences areas. In addition to the guaranteed financial award, entrants were provided with multiple types of opportunities to publicize their submissions with other potential funders if they so chose. And this type of challenger competitions may serve as a tool to spur and identify and discover talent in developing countries. And finally, engaging the public in communicating the importance of supporting fundamental scientific research, especially creative blue sky ideas that pursue big questions of fundamental importance to humanity, is an area in which the foundation has also been putting more efforts in recent years. And funding agencies should increase collaboration, not only in providing financial resources to research, but also in this area of public engagement and outreach. And just as Abdeslam's contributions have been honored and highlighted throughout this conference, we need to recognize and communicate the importance of basic science and the beneficial impacts it brings to society in various ways, so as to raise awareness of their societal impacts and contribution and improve the appreciation of them by public. In developing countries, I view this as an important integral component in supporting scientific research, and it should be part of the scientific ecosystem so that the next generation of scientists is encouraged to ask and pursue research on big questions which drive innovations in science and its long-term impact on society. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ayako. Please join me in welcoming Antonino Zakiki from the World Laboratory.
Waiting for the technology to go on, I would like to thank Professor Coelho. He's asking us, funding basic sciences and development, building research capacity, ideas, institutions, and investment. So, ideas, a project for mankind. This is our proposal. Science for peace the world over. This has been also called the New Manhattan Project. Of course, I have no time to illustrate this enormous project, but I would like to convince you that we need, indeed, to propose a new Manhattan Project. What is the Manhattan Project? I had the great privilege of knowing all members of the Manhattan Project, but Enrico Fermi, because he died too young, and I was a fellow 20 years old when he died, unfortunately. So the new Manhattan Project is indeed the proposal we want to make, and hundreds of physicists are working on it. Why it was called the new Manhattan Project, the project for mankind? Because Pope Francis says that we are not on a peace period. There are so many wars in the world. So he defined this, he said, world war. The Manhattan Project has been implemented as a consequence of the Second World War. Let me recall you that before 1940, the war nuclear did not exist. This is why the bomb which destroyed Hiroshima and Nagasaki was called atomic. It's a nuclear bomb, it's not atomic. You know why it is called atomic? Because the leaders of the project were Enrico Fermi, Wigner, Oppenheimer, and a high-level military fellow. When they demonstrated that the bomb was working, they had to give a name to the bomb. And of course, Oppenheimer, Fermi, and Wigner said, nuclear bomb. They said, well, nuclear does not exist. No one understands what is. The greatest scientific frontier is atomic. And this is why a nuclear bomb has been called atomic. This is the reason why we said the culture of our time is not scientific. It's pre-Aristotelic, because neither science nor mathematics are members of this that we call modern culture. Now, in 1938, nuclear fission was discovered. In 1940, the project was approved. In 1945, reactors, which is peaceful nuclear fire, and bombs were reality. Suppose that in 1897, when Thomson discovered the electron, there was a Manhattan project for the electron technology. Thomson called the smallest piece of electricity electron, and we now are in the electronic technology. It took 100 years. This is why people say, well, look, scientific discoveries take 100 years to become technology for everyday life. Wrong, because there was no a Manhattan project for the electron. Otherwise, we would have here now the technology that our future generation will have in the year 2214. We have lost 100 years. This is the meaning of the new Manhattan project. Thank you very much for the 30 seconds left. Where is the money coming from? This is a crucial point. Democratic governments are elected, so people have to vote for them. If we do not defend ourselves, insisting on the fact that the motto for progress is scientific discovery, we are lost. We already see what is the enormous difference between what we think and the real world. In 1980, the Area Statement was diffused in the world and signed by thousands of scientists. In 85, Reagan and Gorbachev in Geneva declared formally that secret labs have to be open if we really want to have an era of peace. Secret labs are still closed. Why? Because the Berlin Wall collapsed. We should not be pessimistic, nevertheless. Why? Because despite of all these confusions, ICTP is an example of a dream becoming reality. And the World Lab helps ICTP. We have implemented in the world 100 projects in 50 countries. But we should not forget that the new step is if we succeed in having a project for mankind, the new Manhattan project, to solve the 72 planetary emergencies which no one is speaking about, but very few fellows, and Abdus one was one of these fellows. The 72 planetary emergencies are the problems to be solved by the new Manhattan project. I have no time to illustrate this, but I just wanted to show you what is going on. Those who want to join us, please contact us in the different institutions we are present, like the ICTP. Thank you very much.
These are impossibly short time frames for really complex topics. Thank you, Dr. Zakiki. Let me welcome Thomas Ofterhede from South Africa.
Thank you very much, Ian. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, like global capital, scientists and the process of science go where they can best reproduce themselves, where the conditions for their reproduction is ideal. There are a number of factors that determine those conditions. I'd like to speak about four of them, because if those four are well understood and well communicated by research funders and agencies and science administrators, and if they cooperate with each other to maximize those conditions, then we maximize the opportunities for the growth of science globally and specifically in the developed world. I'd like to demonstrate the correlations between those factors and the growth of science by using some examples from South Africa. The first one is obviously the inputs of funding and of human capital. The second factor is the notion of a strategic research focus. The problems have to be focused for researchers to be able to work on them. And lastly, international cooperation as a strategic imperative. This is just a quick diagram of the investments made in a range of knowledge generation projects or programs in South Africa through our National Research Foundation. And you can see that there's a significant increase over this period of time from 2005 to 2017. We already know our budgets generally 3 years in advance. This is a graph showing the investments made in our human capital development programs. And again, you can see a significant increase over this period of time through our National Research Foundation. These are only public funds I'm talking about here. This is not private sector money. Over that same period, this here is a growth illustrating the growth in research output from South Africa and its contribution to the world average, to the world production. The proportion of our population is 0.6. So at this stage, we're producing almost over 7% of world production, which is considerably more than our population percentage. This is the increase in the number of doctorates produced over a 10-year period. It's almost doubled. Unfortunately, the number of science, engineering, and technology PhDs is lagging from where we would like it to be. This diagram, or this table here, illustrates how over just a 4-year period, we've been able to increase the number of students that are supported financially from public funding at the honors, masters, and PhD level, and these numbers have increased by factors between 8 and 10 over this period. And of course, that's easy to achieve if you simply reduce the per capita amounts over the same time. But in fact, we've been able to treble the per capita amount over that same time as well. Turning to demographics. Demographics are an issue that have been raised in this conference previously. In South Africa, in fact, it turns out 43% of full-time equivalent researchers are women, and this is using the Frascati manual as a benchmark for measuring this in the R&D survey, which most of your countries undertake on an annual basis, which is 10% more than the OECD average. However, the racial demographics of the research body in South Africa are not yet nearly representative of the nation. Now, apart from this being a moral and ethical issue, it's also a research management issue, because it's absurd to think if you accept that intelligence is distributed statistically equally across gender and racial differences, if that is something you accept, and I would assume that in this room probably everybody accepts that, then you cannot build the future of your research on the basis of a small percentage of your population. And for those reasons alone, it's logical that you need to take these things into account, and in particular in South Africa, with a racially divided history like ours, this is of great concern to us. These investments and increases in productivity have already started manifesting themselves at a macro level. This is an indicator, the number of PhDs per million of population, which some of you may be familiar with. It's an important indicator. It's used by various international organizations to rate a country's creditworthiness. It's part of an index. And you can see that index has begun to rise in South Africa over this period. This here is a diagram just showing the impact of the top publications in South Africa. And you can see here that anything above one is above global average. So in the regions of environmental sciences and ecology, astronomy and astrophysics, and social sciences, these are areas which we have identified as being of strong strategic interest to South Africa, and we have been investing in them for the last decade very heavily. And you can see that in those areas, our impact at the global level is significantly above the global average. Turning to the last of the factors of production, if you wish, that has to do with international collaboration. This diagram here illustrates the impact of internationally co-published papers involving South African authors, the top 1, 10, and 20%. And you can see that all of them are significantly above one, which is the global average, and the impact has been increasing over the last years. If you just remember that on average, they're all significantly above one. This here is the same graph showing the impact of papers published by only South African authors with no international cooperation. And you can see that the impact of all of these is considerably below one. So showing that the international impact of internationally co-published papers is significantly higher than those which are published only through domestic cooperation. So therefore, these three factors of production strongly correlated. That's financial and human resources, scientific focus, and international cooperation. If these are maximized, the impacts and growth of a nation's research can be maximized too. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. Let's now welcome Alejandro Cacciato from the Ministry of Science, Technology, and Innovation in Argentina. We're going to save the minister for last.
How much time? What? 3 minutes. Okay. Good morning, everybody. Well, first of all, I would like to thank Professor Quevedo for his kind invitation to join this big celebration of ICTP's 50 years of existence. Argentina has largely benefited from ICTP since its very inception. In fact, the center is responsible for the very existence of several research groups of excellence in Argentina. Now, the organizers of this panel asked me to say a few words on funding basic science and development. Basic science and development. In particular, the panel raises the question, how can funding agencies, academic institutions, and ministries of science around the world better collaborate to promote science? In particular, this session two is specifically devoted to building research capacity. So I'm going to address just one point, challenges and opportunities of international partnerships and collaboration. The collaboration with funding agencies of other countries has been the main strategy in Argentina during the last few years to support basic research beyond, of course, the standard grants for local research groups. Although this policy might not be universally valid for all developing countries, it has proved to be very effective for Argentine science. In particular, we have included in the roadmap of the Ministry of Science, Technology, and Innovation several big international collaborations, some of them hosting the main facilities and others in which we simply support the participation of local groups in the projects. In this way, we guaranteed, with a relatively modest investment, both a high level of education of the young researchers involved and the excellence in science. Just to give you a few examples of international collaboration with Argentinian researchers are already involved or are planning to be involved in the future, I would like to mention the Pirogier Observatory and its possible extension. This is, as you probably know, a big international cooperation for cosmic ray observation. It's located in Malargüe in Mendoza province in Argentina. 18 countries, 100 institutions, around 500 scientists, engineers, and technicians. The observatory covers 3,000 kilometers square of flat surface with 1,600 surface detectors and 24 fluorescent telescopes. Another project is the Plan Andes Laboratory for Underground Science. This project involved building an underground lab of 4,000 square meters in the Agua Negra Tunnel between San Juan Province in Argentina and the Coquimbo region in Chile. This location ensures maximum rock thickness of over 1,750 meters for better protection from cosmic radiation. The estimated cost of the lab without equipment is $20 million and will be the first international facility of this kind in the Southern Hemisphere. Another project is building a multi-purpose research nuclear reactor with a neutron source. This is going to be done by our National Atomic Commission, and the reactor will be used for radioisotope production and testing of new fuels and nuclear materials. The neutron beams will have application in basic research and technology in the fields of nuclear engineering, material science, nuclear medicine, etc. It will also serve as a regional facility for cooperation with other Latin American countries. Our National Space Program is another area of strong cooperation with the world. We have a cooperation with NASA and another seven space agencies of developed countries. Argentina built the SAC-D satellite actually in orbit. It was launched in 2011. The budget for that project was $60 million. Well, there are many other projects in which Argentina is cooperating with different countries. I believe the importance of this collaboration will boost Argentine science, while at the same time will save money and efforts. We think these are concrete examples of opportunities for international partnerships from which we have benefited very much in the spirit of the panel suggestions. I hope other developing countries will increase their international collaboration, since in the end it will redound not only in a better use of their own limited resources, but in a benefit for all parties involved. And finally, let me add a simple remark. It was said several times in this conference that there's no applied science and technology and ultimately development without basic science. I fully agree with that. I'm not going to argue against that. But let me add the following. Basic science doesn't spill in good applied science and technology. Countries, developing countries, need deliberate actions to have technology and to develop. The dilemma is not basic science and excellence against development. The point is that basic science and excellence without development is a tragedy. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And last but very much not least, please join me in welcoming the Honorable Zahid Hamid, Minister of Science and Technology for Pakistan.
Thank you. Mr. Fernando Quevedo, distinguished scientists, academicians, fellow panelists, ladies and gentlemen, assalamu alaikum and a very good afternoon to you all. It is an honor and a privilege and a great pleasure to be here in Trieste today to participate in the 50th anniversary celebrations of the Dr. Abdus Salam International Center for Theoretical Physics. And I would like to begin by congratulating on this auspicious occasion the members of the governing body, that is the government of Italy, the UNESCO, International Atomic Energy Commission, the eminent scientists and academicians on the Scientific Council, Director Fernando Quevedo and his entire administrative team, and the faculty staff, and thousands of students from all around the world, all members of the ICTP family, who have worked or are still working to make ICTP one of the leading scientific organizations of our time. These celebrations are, of course, of a very special and emotional nature for the people of Pakistan, because, as you know, the founding father of ICTP, the much admired and acclaimed Nobel laureate Dr. Abdus Salam, was a very illustrious son of Pakistan. As we heard yesterday from his friends and colleagues, Dr. Salam was a visionary, a brilliant scientist, and an outstanding human being who became one of the greatest physicists of his time. It was very touching to see all the love, affection, and regard shown for him yesterday by all the speakers, and to listen to the very emotional and poignant remarks of all the members of his family. The ICTP dream would not have become a reality without the guiding spirit and the untiring efforts of Dr. Salam. And while celebrating its 50th anniversary, we cannot but pay tribute not just to his scientific achievements, but also to his unlimited compassion for the plight of the poor in the developing countries whose life he wanted to better, utilizing scientific know-how as an instrument of change. ICTP, with its marvelous achievements and its glorious future, is a wonderful monument to his memory. It is a vivid proof of his belief that science is a common and shared heritage of all mankind. We in Pakistan are proud of him and his legacy. I am pleased to inform you that a number of the causes espoused by Dr. Abdus Salam continue to flourish in Pakistan, including the International Nathiagali Summer College, the National Center for Physics in Qaid-e-Azam University, the Commission on Science and Technology for Sustainable Development in the South, COMSATS, and the Salam Prize for young Pakistani scientists who have made notable achievements in physics or mathematics. On a very personal note, I may state that I am a politician, but believe it or not, I also studied mathematics. And in 1965, the year after ICTP was established, I went up to Cambridge University to study for the Mathematics Tripos Part 1. And I remember that in various discussions and lectures, many speakers spoke about Dr. Salam and about his brilliant academic record and achievements. Ever since then, I had hoped to visit ICTP, and I am very grateful to Director Fernando Quevedo for inviting me to these celebrations and for providing me an opportunity to fulfill my long-standing wish, and that too on such an auspicious occasion. I would like to avail the opportunity of wishing ICTP the very best in the future. Now, quickly back to the theme of this discussion. I'm sorry, I'll try to finish as quickly as I can. It is now universally acknowledged that the socio-economic development of a country depends upon its scientific and technological base and capacity. And in view of the rapid developments of science and technology over the last 50 years, particularly in the new emerging technologies, it is necessary for developing countries to make concerted efforts to develop their science and technology research capacity if they are to progress in the new globalized economic world order. For this purpose, policymakers have a crucial role to play in facilitating the creation of a complete ecosystem for all stakeholders, including researchers and technicians, academicians, and representatives of industry and other funding agencies, which is conducive for conducting need-based research. Development of institutional capacity to conduct effective research must, therefore, be a key element of research and development policy. In many developing countries, including Pakistan, the problem is not that the government does not recognize the importance of science and technology for economic growth. It is the resource constraint. In the case of Pakistan, because of numerous socio-economic challenges and pressures, including natural disasters and national security issues, sufficient funds could not be allocated in the past for capacity building in science and technology, necessitating focus of R&D efforts on finding solutions to current problems for self-reliance and sustainable development in various fields, including agriculture, biotechnology, healthcare, care, clean drinking water, and sanitation. The present government of Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif has attached high priority to the science and technology sector. We have prepared a holistic science, technology, and innovation strategy for the next 4 years, following formulation of a national policy in 2012. And this aims at the rapid development of human resources and provision of quality education and meaningful employment to the growing young segment of the population, so as to realize the huge demographic dividend that is potentially available from our population, 50% of which is under the age of 25. Measures are also being adopted to establish strong linkages among the research institutes and the academic institutions on the one hand, and the public sector entities, industry, and individual entrepreneurs on the other hand, with a view to reorienting research and development towards market requirements and thereby enhancing its contribution to national socioeconomic development. At present, Pakistan's expenditure on R&D is only 0.3% of GDP, which needs to be increased substantially for meaningful or significant contribution to economic growth. It is planned to reach 1% of GDP by 2018. In view of these limited resources, this requires that goals be prioritized and allocated funds for R&D, that they be utilized more effectively in fields which yield the greatest economic and social benefits. Pakistan has recently released its long-term vision and strategy for socioeconomic development named Vision 2025, which recognizes that investment in human resources and development of science and technology infrastructure are critical elements. And for this purpose, it is proposed to significantly increase the investment in human resources. We have undertaken major reforms in the higher education and research sector. Today, over 1 million students are enrolled in our university, and exciting things are happening in that sector. Pakistan is spending only about 2% of its GDP on education, and of course the government plans to increase this dramatically in coming years, especially in higher education. Public expenditure is expected to reach 4% of GDP by 2018. Plans include building a worldwide education and research network of universities, which will allow institutions to initiate research through the government and the private sector, enabling them to create an international partnership program. Focus will be on quality, and funds will be provided to encourage excellence in teaching and knowledge transfer, as well as excellence in research. Apart from the features I have mentioned, a crucial element for a successful research ecosystem is resource mobilization. And a resource mobilization mechanism has to be put in place which ensures generation of adequate funds to priority research areas. In the case of Pakistan, this also means tapping the huge, or mobilizing the huge Pakistani diaspora. And we are providing incentives to scientists for enhancing research capacity. This has worked well. The Research Productivity Award in the form of a monetary incentive has led to a marked increase in the number of annual publications in quality international journals from 600 to about 11,000 now in the last year. Incentives are also being provided for faculty members who successfully supervise PhD students, and this has also resulted in a dramatic rise in the number of PhDs being approved. Special incentives, including tax rebates, are being given to the private sector for spending more on R&D. Unfortunately, these are not working so well, and therefore we are now considering various novel schemes, such as allowing industry associations to donate money for this purpose, forming clusters of companies working in the vertical chain to allow them to fund R&D, and also to specify technological products which can be assigned to the private sector for manufacturing purposes. There are a number of challenges of a universal nature which require to be tackled through international partnerships, and Pakistan is an active member of a number of intergovernmental and regional organizations dealing with science and technology issues. It is proud to be host to the Commission on Science and Technology for Sustainable Development in the South, COMSATS, which I mentioned, which is an idea of Dr. Abdus Salam. It is also the host of the Organization of Islamic Cooperation Standing Committee on Scientific and Technological Cooperation, COMSTEC, which is a ministerial standing committee of 57 member states, and the largest political platform in the world on science and technology after the United Nations. The third intergovernmental organization in Islamabad is the Eco-Science Foundation, which was established in 2011 for the eco-region. And finally, I am pleased to state, as was also mentioned by the Director General CERN the other day, Pakistan will soon become an associate member of CERN, which will provide a platform for Pakistani scientists and engineers to work in projects involving scientists from all around the world. A number of suggestions for consideration of ICTP. Many young scientists from Pakistan have benefited from various programs of the ICTP. We would like to send many more. And we were very pleased to hear from the Director Quevedo yesterday that plans are being made to increase the faculty. We hope that this can be expedited to enable more students from around the world to benefit from this excellent organization. Also, we were very pleased to note from the previous session that ICTP is now setting up regional branches or centers around the world, and we are very keen that such a center should also be established in Pakistan. For this purpose, I would like to suggest, I believe the proposal has already been mooted, that the National Center for Physics in Islamabad be considered for this purpose, which was set up in accordance with the wishes of Dr. Salam and remained, as you know, under the management of his close friend and colleague, Professor Riazuddin, until his death last year. In conclusion, I would like to dedicate on this auspicious occasion a verse from another great Pakistani, the poet of the East, Allama Muhammad Iqbal, to the Abdus Salam International Center for Theoretical Physics, to each member of the faculty, and to the galaxy of scientists from all over the world who are part of the ICTP family. The verse relates to the quest for knowledge and research, and it is in Persian, but I would like to quote the English translation. Its words, I would say, very aptly fit this great institution. What can I do? My nature is averse to rest. My heart is impatient like the breeze in the poppy field. When the eye beholds an object of beauty, the heart yearns for something more beautiful still. From the spark to the star, from the star to the sun is my quest. I have no desire for a goal. For me, rest spells death. With an impatient eye and a hopeful heart, I seek for the end of that which is endless. Thank you for your attention. God bless you all.